Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Energy Efficiency Dialogues Towards a Sustainable Future. I am Sumedha Awasthi, Project Manager, IIEC. We are using the GoToWebinar interface for conducting this webinar, and we would like to inform you that this will be recorded, and the recording will be made available to everyone once the webinar is over. And we will keep all microphones and webcams on mute for the entire duration of the webinar to avoid any accidental background disturbances. During the webinar, if you have any questions or comments, please share the same using the questions or chat options available. You can see your chat tab on the right side of the screen, and we will take the questions during the question and answer round at the end of the after the speakers have spoken. Firstly, I would like to welcome our speakers. We have with us today Mr. S.P. Garnayak, Executive Director, EESL, Mr. A.K. Asthana, Retired Senior Advisor, GIZ India, Mr. Jayesh Goswami, General Manager, EPSL Trigeneration, Dr. Anand Shukla, AGM, ESL, Mr. Abhishek Duper, ICA, Mr. Girja Shankar, General Manager, ESL, Mr. Manoj Kumar, Project Manager, ESL, and Mr. Sanjay Dubey, CEO, IIEC. So I would like to thank all the speakers to take out the time from their busy schedules and join us in the webinar. So just to give a brief about why we are conducting this webinar, so EESL, along with IIEC, is conducting the stakeholder webinar with building owners, industry, corporate leaders in the eastern and southern part of the country to share and discuss the innovative energy efficiency mechanisms and schemes, along with their success stories to initiate the dialogue and provide support in overcoming the technical and financial mechanisms to where industries and corporates can work with EESL for the design and implementation of energy efficiency programs in the future. So without taking much time, I would like to invite Mr. Manoj Kumar, Project Manager, ESL, to give the welcome address. Mr. Manoj Kumar is working as Project Manager for the GEF project, creating and sustaining markets for energy efficiency at ESL. He has over 12 years of experience working with UN organizations, lateral financial institutions, national financial institutions, as at various capacities in the fields of climate change, energy efficiency, renewable energy, and carbon finance. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sumedha. Thank you, Sumedha. I hope I am audible. Sumedha,
yes, yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, a warm good morning to all of you who have gathered here. Hope all your dear and near ones are safe and healthy during these testing times. It is my pleasure and an honor to deliver the welcome address. As you are aware, Energy Efficiency Services Limited, a company under Ministry of Power, have been working strenuously in the field of energy efficiency. EESL is implementing world's largest energy efficiency portfolio across sectors like lighting, buildings, electric mobility, smart metering, cooling, and agriculture at a scale. Over the last few years, EESL has been diversifying its portfolio to focus on industrial and commercial sector and has initiated relevant programs projects. Energy efficiency has become even more important now during this COVID-19 situation and can be a potential tool to reduce the OPEX cost of the industrial and commercial sector, and by doing so, support them sail through these tough times. During our journey, we at ESL understand the necessity and usefulness of regular interaction with the sector to understand their needs and thought process and possible areas of collaboration. With this objective, we have been conducting a series of workshops, seminars, roundtable conferences, and focus group discussions. And with changing times, we are doing such events through web platforms. Today's event is being held under the aegis of a global environment facility project, which is being implemented by ESL in association with UNEP and ADB, with the objective to promote and sustain energy efficiency activities and markets in India. For today's interaction, we have an interesting mix of speakers from both within and outside ESL, having decades of experience in their area of expertise. Without further ado, I would like to extend a warm welcome to Mr. S.P. Garnayak, Executive Director, ESL, to this event. Mr. Garnayak has been spearheading initiatives on industrial and building energy efficiency, and it would be enthusing to listen to him. We are fortunate to have Mr. A.K. Asthana, sir. Is one of the flag bearers of industrial energy efficiency in the country, and we are eager to listen to you, sir. Sir, a warm welcome to you. I would also like to welcome the panelists, Dr. Anand Shukla, who would be discussing about ESL's super efficient AC program, Mr. J.S. Goswami would be discussing about trigeneration technology and PSLC initiatives, and Mr. Abhishek Dhupar would be discussing about National Motor Replacement Program. I would also like to welcome Mr. Girja Shankar, Head Corporate Event Programs in ESL, who would be delivering the closing remarks. I also welcome Mr. Sanjay Dubey, CEO, IAEC, who are supporting ESL in the conduct of this event. I welcome all ESL and other colleagues from partner agencies who have joined this event from different locations. Last but not the least, the hero and heroines of today's program, I welcome all participants who have taken out their precious time and have joined this webinar to take forward the energy efficiency dialogue to the next level. I once again extend a warm welcome to all and look forward to interacting with you. Thank you. Over to you, Sumita.
Thank you, Mr. Manoj, for the insights and the welcome address. Now I would like to invite Mr. Sanjay Dubey to set the theme for the discussion. Mr. Dubey is the CEO of IAEC. He has over 32 years of experience, and his dynamic portfolio consists of working on clean energy and climate change related programs. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sumita. Thank you, Mr. Garnayak, Mr. Sthana, Jayeshi, Manoj, Anandji, and Abhishek, and all the participants. This time is absolutely right for doing this kind of meetings and webinars, because after over a recovery to coming out of this pandemic gradually, we need to focus more on the efforts that we can handle ourselves, and energy efficiency or energy conservation is the best available resource that we have in our hand, because I always believe that this is not a one-time activity that you do something and then sit ideal. This is a process that starts, and then you keep optimizing to reach certain level and then further optimize. So every time you learn, and we also call it energy conservation, energy efficiency, also like improved energy performance in all sectors, whether it is industry, agriculture, building, domestic, all sectors, and transport, they need optimization and improve performance of energy to save on resources. ESL, that journey started a couple of years back, has now many successful examples and pilots and programs that are running successfully, not only in India, but other part of the world also. And this dialogue basically is being organized, as Manojji explained in detail, to reach out to you, to help you, so that once you get out of this pandemic problem, how to resolve your own issues, to further optimize on your resources, save your money, save energy, save electricity, how to utilize new technologies, what are them, what are the programs, what are the incentives within those programs available to further encourage you to go for energy efficiency. And these are the very important thing. And one more very important aspect is that, our own human behavior, unless we are not, familiarized or introduced with some of these aspects, sometimes we sit on a back seat, and then try to wait for a right time to do that. But I think reminding at the right time and then getting into this, and then also providing you some examples and incentives and which are available in the market by ESL, will certainly bring some clarity in your mind and motivate you to go forward and implement these aspects. And then also, this is an open dialogue. Maybe later you can ask a few questions. And then after the webinar, we highly encourage you to go and meet senior executives at ESL, and then see how this partnership can go further, and we can maximize the benefits of energy efficiency to take this country forward, become one of the world's best country in terms of energy efficiency. So this is the entire purpose, and this is a ESL's best effort to reach out to you. And we are lucky enough as IIC to facilitate this process. And I'm very sure that you will also feel good after listening to all the eminent speakers who are present here. They'll be very focused. They'll present you all the good side of the program, and then their learnings, and also how you can participate in that. So I'll not take much time. I'll hand it over back to Sumedha so that then you can start listening from them. And then also what Mr. Garnayak has to say, because he has been leading these successful efforts in ESL. He has been a big support providing person to this sector, many contributions. So over to you, Sumedha, so that you can initiate this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I want to remind all our attendees that you can please post your questions on the right side in the chat box, and we will be taking the questions after in the question answer round after all our speakers have spoken. Now I would like to invite Mr. S.P. Garnayak to give the keynote address on ESL's Integrated Energy Efficiency Services Approach. Mr. Garnayak is presently serving as Executive Director and Business Unit Head in ESL. During his 25 years of professional career, Mr. Garnayak has served in government, bilateral and international organizations at various capacities in the field of energy policy, energy management and resource conservation. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. I hope I am audible.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you very much. So good morning to everyone. Mr. Astana, Mr. Dubey, my colleagues from ESL, Mr. Joyce Goswami, Dr. Anand Shukla, Manoj, Abhishek from ICA, who have been, leading this entire activities on the National and Motor Replacement Program. Ladies and gentlemen, who are attending this program virtually, although we are passing through a very, very tough time. I think the set has been, the context has been set here by Mr. Dubey, just to highlight that how this energy efficiency or the resource conservation has been one of the most important aspects as far as our operations in manufacturing sector or even commercial or building sectors are concerned. You may be encountering about 20 to 25% or even more. That's the percentage. That is the energy cost if you compare it with your overall manufacturing cost in any of the sectors. So this actually gives a food for thought that how we are actually going to reduce this cost as far as possible through innovative ideas, bringing new and new interventions, even also attending the low-hanging fruits. I think after the enactment of the Energy Conservation Act in 2002, and there have been a lot of schemes coming forward from Bureau of Energy Efficiencies or the state designated agencies in various states, there have been certain initiatives in the recent past, particularly in the last 5 to 6 years. But that has actually, if you just see the overall energy efficiency market in the country, it roughly stands at about some $15 billion to even $20 billion. But in today's context, if you just see, various studies have given different numbers, but we have not even reached to $1.5 to $2 billion. That's the thing which we have actually captured from this energy efficiency, as far as the energy efficiency market is concerned. So the market is very huge. The market is burgeoning. The sectors are coming forward. There has been management outlook, change in the management outlook in the over the years. But the overall, if you just see, the most important thing which is actually troubling the entire energy efficiency movement is the investment part. Although we appreciate, acknowledge the technological things that any energy efficiency, an energy efficient technology gives you a payback period of say about 2 years or 3 years or even lesser than that. At the same time, also it gives you say 20 or 25% or even 10%, 15% energy saving as compared to the baseline. But the most important thing is that who is going to put money. And in the context where the business has slowed down due to various reasons, particularly due to the pandemic, then it makes a sense to actually look for some innovative financing mechanisms or the business models which can actually give you a win-win situation for everyone. That is where ESL has been in the forefront. We have tried our best in addressing such issues in various sectors. So I have a very small presentation which will take you through. Is this presentation visible to all of you?
Yes, sir, it is.
Okay. So I'll just take you through. So this is an energy cost reduction through the integrated energy efficiency services model. So this is what I gave you the background and how this ESL has been in the recent past has performed. And as you may be knowing, Energy Efficiency Services Limited was established under the aegis of National Mission on Enhanced Energy Efficiency. This is an extended arm of Bureau of Energy Efficiency to implement large-scale energy efficiency projects. More precisely, the activities started from the year 2015 onwards. And what we have seen that more than 54 billion units of electricity per year has been saved, and more than 10,000 megawatt of capacity addition has been avoided as far as electricity is concerned. So we have been targeting in various sectors, whether it is municipality, whether it is building, in the industrial sector, electricity distribution companies, DISCOMs, and so on and so forth. So to do this, we work in a very innovative business models. So we raise our own fundings from various financial institutions to invest in these projects. And for that, we have also reached out to the global financial institutions who are supporting our growth. And some of the numbers are shown here. Just to highlight what are the initiatives being taken, because that will give a kind of glimpse or some idea what ESL has been doing or is proposed to do in the next years coming forward. So in the Ujala program, that is the domestic efficient lighting program, more than 36 crores of LED bulbs have been distributed, LED lights, tube lights, and some super efficient fans as per the B star rating program. The more important and the successful program and the largest program of ESL is the LED street lighting program, which we are doing in over 1600 urban local bodies.
Okay.
So this is about more than 1 crore number of electricity, street lights have been installed, and it is being installed, it is being operated with a business model where there is no upfront investment by the municipalities. Entire investment is done by ESL and is being paid back to us through the monetized energy saving in a span of about 7 years. We have also addressed in to retrofit the older appliances with new energy efficient appliances in over 10,400 buildings across the country, which this is a very, very successful program. We call it the Building Energy Efficiency Program. We have replaced more than seven. I would request those who are not speaking, can you please mute their mic, because I'm getting some background disturbances. So the 74,000 agricultural pumps have been also replaced. 1 million street light smart meters have been also replaced under the Smart Meter National Program. Going in the clean energy initiative, you just see we have done works in the solar LED street lights in 5 states of the country. This is a program by Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. We have distributed 63 lakhs of solar study lamps to the school-going children. It's a beautiful model, beautiful program. I'm not going to discuss in more detail. We have also installed 80 megawatt of decentralized solar plant. I think the numbers, we are adding more and more every day, every week. We have deployed so far 1,500 electric vehicles. To do so, 470 AC and DC captive chargers have been installed across the country. So these have been supported by various multilateral and bilateral technical support as well as financial support which we have got. So and there is a program on trigeneration also that I think my colleague Mr. Joyce Goswami will highlight. That is just journey which I not trying to capture it here, which are more prominent are milestones which have come from 2009 to 2020 so far. 2015, in fact, we started the program, this LED program. It's a national program launched by Honorable Prime Minister. And in 2017, we had a global footprint. We acquired one company from UK to work in the combined heat and power sector and as well as in the tri-generation sector. And we launched our annual international event called Inspire, which is being attended by more than 25 countries. So in 2019, we touched 1 crore number of street lights, as I said earlier. And in that process, we became the largest, managing the largest fleet of street lights in the world. And we are aspiring more. We want to go into the more and more innovative areas, clean energy areas, working on the carbon financing side. That is what we are trying to do. So in the sustainable development side, if you just see this integrated energy efficiency solutions, we have already conceptualized it and tried it in various corporates. So we are in that process. We are trying to reach out to you how to explore further partnerships with ESL, this will actually give a win-win situation for everybody who is coming and being a partner to us. So there has been this energy efficiency solutions. We are having a business model. There have been implementation modalities, and there has been some tangible results also. So what is overall sees that this sustainable development program, it actually not only highlights only the energy point of view, but also addresses the resource conservation, whether it is water, whether it is lubricants, whether it is the waste minimization. And the value proposition, what actually we bring to the table is that, I think there are certain background noise. I would request please unmute your microphone.
Then we must have a three network connection. Slow network connection.
Okay. Can you please mute if you are not speaking?
Anand, can you mute from your end?
I have muted everybody.
Okay, so going forward, thank you very much. So this is the value proposition which ESL is bringing to the table. There is a problem statement. It takes the feasibility. Okay, so I don't know, I am not able to see my presentation.
So we can see the presentation.
Okay, but I am not able to see. Just
let me just check.
Okay, so well, I was just explaining about the value propositions which we are working on. The problem statements, the feasibility studies, preparation of detailed project reports, diagnostic studies, comprehensive energy audits, these are being taken care of with our in-house expertise as well as with suitable partnerships. The most important thing, as I said, the investment, we mobilize the investment as it is desired. And the model which we are working is the pay-as-you-save model. This is what we call it as a ESCO model, where the entire investment is done by us and you need to pay back to us from a time period to recover our investments. The most important point here is that we follow a procurement process which is actually based on the demand aggregation. So there is economy of scale. So this economy of scale reduces the overall price. If you say the, if I tell about the the case of the lighting, the domestic lighting program, if you see the 9-watt bulb, which was about 300 or 320 rupees in 2015, now has been crashed down to about 50 rupees with a demand aggregation approach or with a bulk procurement approach. So this is exactly what we follow, and being a government organization, we follow the all government procurement guidelines. The implementation is taken care of by ESL again for all these projects, and there is no hassle from the end user point of view regarding the implementation. But again, it depends upon what kind of project it is being taken forward. The project management is also same. So what we have seen that over the years, all these programs have been more transparent in the form that we have created more and more dashboards, more and more management tools to show that what are the kind of results are coming from this implementation of these projects. So this, if you just see this, sustainability action, and we see that 30 to 50% reduction in the cost or energy consumption is possible from the baseline consumption. But here, there may be a lot of other solutions, but what we are trying to discuss it here that There is an industrial lighting solution. There is a super efficient air conditioners, which my people, my team will be speaking to you. There is a national motor replacement program, which is actually replacing, trying to replace the old inefficient motors with IE3 motors, which is precisely efficient. There is a tri-generation component, which talks about generating electricity, heating and cooling from a single source, so thereby improving the overall efficiency. We also try to deploy the electric vehicle, so we are bringing the greening, green transportation into your premise. And there is a, recently we also, the Honorable Power Minister launched this program, that is, we call it as a RAIS, that is the retrofit of air conditioning of the indoor air, through indoor air quality, for safety and efficiency. So this is an air quality system. We have done already 3 pilot projects in our old building. We did it in Shram Shakti Bhavan, that is Ministry of Power, as well as Ministry of Home Affairs. So we are trying to take it to the other context in the present COVID situation, which can actually address the issue of air quality as well as the energy efficiency. So as you know, these are very simple slide. The saving potential ranges from 20% to 70%, depending upon the what kind of intervention it is, and with a simple payback period, roughly between 1.1 year to 3 years. And if you say that these are the ESL's national programs, which are actually encompassing, or these programs are under this umbrella of these national programs. I would highlight here the business model, what we call it as a PMC model. This is the very, upfront investment model, which is being preferred by various clients, where in that case, the inventory collection, the procurement facilitation, the warranty obligations, the entire project monitoring, I mean, supply of the things and installation, these are being taken care of by ESL. But the capital cost, the investment is directly done by the client itself. But in that process, in lieu of the services being provided by ESL, ESL takes some kind of PMC fees on it. And this PMC fees varies from 8% to even 12%, 13%, but it is a negotiable item. I mean, depends upon the overall project cost and so. So this is the model being preferred by various industries, various corporates to participate. Let me just give you an example of the Mahindra work, which we did recently. The overall investment was about 16 crores, and we gave them, we intervened in terms of lighting, motors, air conditioners. And in that process, the entire investment was done by Mahindra and Mahindra, but ESL took the entire responsibility, starting from the problem definition, inventory collection, completing the procurement process, vendor selection, and then ensuring that the supply and installation is done. The other model is the ESCO model, which is a very popular model across the world, but we have defined the definition of we have redefined this ESCO concept here in India we work it on a deemed saving approach, where the difference from the PMC model is that the upfront investment is done by ESL. So the rest of the things remain same. The moment I bring investment, so we work with a debt equity manner. So 70 to 80% is the debt, and 20 to 30% we put it as our equity. So there is a cost of financing being added to that. There is a return on equity, and there is some interest rate to the debt. So after that, the project cost is defined, and industry or the end user pays back to us in a quarterly manner, up to 5 years, 4 years, 7 years, depending upon the project period, which is mutually agreed upon. So this is one thing. It looks very simple, LED lighting, industrial lighting, but I have seen that it has been very interesting results. If I just give you the example, we have already deployed more than 40 lakhs of the lights in various industries and buildings, with $85 million as the, more than 500 crores of rupees as the investment. This is the project investment being done either by ESL or by the end user directly. In that process, we have addressed, as I said earlier, over 10,000 buildings, 100 public sector undertaking and industries, and the numbers are still counting. 800 railway stations in the country, we have already replaced those things. 64 airports under Airport Authority of India, and 1,200 banks of ATMs of one bank. So this is the things, and we are trying to enter into various agreement with various other PSUs and industries to look into that. Just to give you an example here, ladies and gentlemen, if I take the case of NTPC, With NTPC, we are supplying the industrial lights every year to them, and about 200 to 220 crores is the kind of revenue, or is the kind of monetary transactions have been occurred in the last 2 years. So roughly about 100 crores, if you just see, that's the kind of the revenue being generated by ESL by supplying these industrial lights to them, and the other PSUs like Gas Authority of India Limited, this Coal India Limited, and many other PSUs have also come forward to come and participate in this program. So in this case, what we have that we see is that 20 to 25% price reduction is there from if you are getting it from a retail marketing or directly from the vendor, because we have gone through a massive way of procurement, that is through a demand aggregation approach from various industries. This is just to, I highlighted you this, the Mahindra case. With this, we created a professional partnership with Mahindra. In fact, we started this engagement in 2017 with a sustainability initiative. ESL provided this LED lighting solution. As you just see, we provided in 17 locations, and 16 lakhs, 1.6 lakhs lights have been distributed with the investment of about 150 million Indian rupees, 15 crores. So this estimated energy savings and estimated CO2 reductions are their results. I have just taken these numbers from there. This is another program which will be dealt to in very in detail. So this is a super efficient air conditioner program which will developed under the with a partnership with ADB, Asian Development Bank, and the United Nations Environment Program. So this is actually a program which we actually trying to go beyond the 5-star rated AC being defined by Bureau of Energy Efficiency. So this particular air conditioner is having a ISEER, that is Indian Seasonal Energy Efficiency Ratio, of 5.4, which is much, much higher than the average 3-star AC. So that means higher is the ISEER value, as you may be knowing, better is the efficiency, and hence the less energy consumption. So we procured about 50,000 numbers of ACs through a public procurement process, open tendering process, and we got a 39,990 inclusive of all taxes and everything. So this price equivalent is actually, if you just compare this, it is a 4-star rated AC as compared to the retail market price. But you are getting a product, I mean, of course, equivalent to about 6-star or 7-star, and it is resulting about 20 to 25% of the energy saving. So we have already, because we started this program of late, and 2,000 plus ACs have been deployed, and about 20,000 air conditioners ACs are in the pipeline. Because of this COVID situation, during the peak season, it could not be picked up. I mean, it could not be taken up the way it should have been. But we hope so that this program, it will be a very, very successful program. Apart from energy efficiency, this particular program, this product is also highlighting the refrigerant, which is having low global warming potential. So we have created a mechanism of how these orders can be taken. I think team will be explaining you, and how this delivery is happening, how this payment is happening, what are the warranty obligations, there is a payback, as well, there is a buyback option also, all these things are there. The other program is the energy efficient IE3 motors. I think after this, the quality order, which came from DIPP, Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion, that minimum energy performance level of the motor, which is to be used from January 2018 is IE2 level. So ESL designed this program, why IE2, go for the next higher level, that is IE3. And with a demand aggregation model, again, we arrived at a cost reduction as compared to the direct purchase or the retail prices. So we are highlighting it, we are covering it from 2.2 kilowatt to 75 kilowatt range with 2-pole, 4-pole and 6-pole with foot and flange mounted motors. Which are driving any of your system, maybe fans, blowers, compressors, or any other thing. We have seen that 15 to 20% of the less cost with a 3 years warranty. Probably this is one of the value addition I would highlight here. The warranty period which you may be getting, that is typically of 1.5 years or 18 months. So we have got an extended warranty here, and with a 15 to 20% less cost. We have done some deployments of these motors, did some pilot projects in 36 locations. So we arrived at, we concluded that about 10 to 15% energy saving is possible. The data would be available in our public domain also. This has been done by a third party observation estimation, and the payback period is somewhere between 1.5 to 2 years. And if you see, we have done in Mahindra, Arvind Group of Industries, ITC, SESASAI Paper and Board Limited, and many more other things. So 4,000 motors have been deployed so far, and there have been, you may be showing, seeing some of the pictures which have been captured during the pilot studies. This is the National Building Program, Building Energy Efficiency Program, which was launched by then Power Minister, Mr. Piyush Goyal. And then we signed the agreement with the government of Maharashtra to address in more than 5,000, more than 3,000 number of buildings. As I said, this is one of the areas which it can be, taken forward as far as your facilities are concerned. This is in the Building Energy Efficiency Program, ESL was fortunate enough to get a mandate from the Ministry of Power as well as Ministry of Finance that ESL would be implementing this program in all the government and private buildings, those who are interested. And the entire investment is done by ESL, so there is no upfront investment burden to the individual. And the saving what you will be getting, that will be paid back from that energy saving. But the entire saving is not actually measured. It is on a deemed saving approach. That is exactly what we are again and again trying to convince to you. So in this process, what you have seen, we have seen that about 60 to 70% of the monetized energy saving is actually what you are going to pay back to us. The rest 20 to 30% is retained with the end user. So this is a very, very win-win situation, and the model has been very, very attractive. This is the program I told you, the details should be available in our website. Filtration, we are doing an air filtration, air ventilation system, and the overall monitoring system. And if you may be showing, seeing this photograph where the Honorable Power Minister released this just 1 month back. This is what we call as a retrofit of air conditioning to improve the indoor air quality and safety, for safety and efficiency. We see this air quality index before the retrofit, as I said, we did in the 3-4 pilot projects, and the air quality after the retrofit, how it has been drastically reduced with some index, air quality index and all. This electric vehicle, just to give you an impression to you, electric vehicles already we covered more than 3 crores green kilometer recently. So this became a news in India. There have been different models we are working, different model of the vehicle, but this is the standard model which is very, very popular as far as users are concerned. So it is greater than 140 kilometer per charge. This works on a leasing model where the entire asset is owned by ESL, but the user takes it the vehicle on a lease kind of thing. So they pay about 22,500 rupees per month as a dry lease. Dry lease means there is no driver attached to it. If the driver is given, then it is a 40,000 per month as the wet lease. And we have already deployed more than 2,000 e-vehicles in the country. Tri-generation, this will be more dealt with my colleague, Mr. Joyce Goswami. I'll skip these slides for the interest of the time and all. But the idea here is that this is a very interesting proposition for the power, for the industries, those who actually require electricity, heating and cooling at a particular at the same time. So if it normally operates in a very simple fundamental of having a gas generator, natural gas generator, where you generate the electricity, and from the exhaust gas, which is having a very high temperature, and depending upon the value of the exhaust gas, you can use a vapor absorption machine to produce the cooling as well as to do the some of the heat can be utilized for heating purposes. So that is why the name is the tri-generation. We have done the first project in one of the industries. My colleague will explain to you. So what we have done, it has also reduced the cost. It's a higher operational efficiency. If you just take from a co-generation plant, the operational efficiency from 55 to 60%, the tri-generation, it goes up to even 75 to 80%. So this is my last slide. Perhaps these are the work which we did in Mahindra and Mahindra as a successful case study. I'm just highlighting here. These are the interventions we did in LED light, in energy efficient motors, super efficient air conditioners, tri-generation. We also reached out the Ujala, distribution of LED bulbs, lights, 5-star rated fans, to over 20,000 of their employees on a single day. That was in the World Environment Day. And we also conducted energy audit and technical training programs for their end users. So we ESL gave this entire thing as a package, and in certain cases with agreed business propositions. And this is what exactly I was just talking about now. This employee engagement program, how we distributed more than 30,000 LED bulbs and 5,000 fans to over 20,000 people on the World Environment Day. So these are some of the things which not only gives a kind of feeling that you are going to save energy or cost in your manufacturing premises, but also gives the possibility to reach out to your fellow consumers, fellow employees, and other people who would be actually benefited and get the sense that how energy efficiency is very vital in the environmental context. So going forward, if any of the corporates are interested, we are in discussion with Aditya Birla Group. We are going to do work with the Steel Authority of India Limited. Few days back, we had a meeting with Secretary Ministry of Steel, and where he has directed on the steel sector to come and participate in such kind of programs. But nevertheless, these are some of the things which we have just highlighted, but it can also go into the other programs like waste heat recovery program, industrial water pumping program, linking to the water energy conservation, water and energy conservation, with a complete study of the water balancing from source to sink, and how that can be actually linked to the investment or linked to the investment as far as the replacement of the pumps or the modification of the pumping system is concerned. So those kind of things can be developed and the investment can be mobilized by ESL. So going forward, I think if somebody is interested, this is the kind of way forward I'm proposing to all of you, signing up a non-binding memorandum of understanding, which will give a kind of a token of appreciation of our engagements, then finalization of the area of the intervention with business model, what kind of solutions you are requiring as a group or as an individual industry, and what is the business model, whether you want to go with a PMC model or with ESCO model or any other things. Then demand aggregation, that can be done for lighting purpose, lighting area or air conditioners, motors, electric vehicles, etc. For major motor other programs like dry generation, waste heat recovery, water pumpings, and etc., this can also lead to a feasibility study which ESL can take up. Subsequently, it can lead to the investment, and then signing of the agreement and the implementation of the project, and thereby documenting the results which would be coming subsequently. So in this process, normally we follow, and we are already, as I said you, in discussion or in agreement with various people. So through IIAC, let me just compliment the entire team of IIAC. We are reaching out to you people just to come forward and participate with ESL, engage with ESL in this national programs of, these programs of national interest. So thank you very much. I think I'll stop it here. I took a lot of time, but team will be explaining you more detail about the technicalities and other terms and conditions of these programs. But I'll be reached out to you, with my email ID, and the Twitter account is there. So please reach out to me if you have any queries and clarifications to be made. Thank you very much for joining once again, and look forward to a very, very fruitful discussion going forward. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Karnaik sir, for explaining all the programs in brief and the very interesting Mahindra and Mahindra case study. Now we have with us Mr. A.K. Astana. He will be speaking about the need and importance of industrial energy efficiency. Mr. A.K. Astana has experience of over 46 years in the area of energy conservation, audit, resource optimization, waste reduction in all types of large and SME energy incentive industries. He retired from GIZ in March as senior technical expert. Before joining GIZ, he has served as a group head energy management in National Productivity Council for over 34 years. He was also engaged with some flagship programs of Bureau of Energy Efficiency under Energy Conservation Act 2001, such as the National Level Certification Examination for Energy Manager and Energy Auditor, Perform Achieve and Trade Scheme for Large Industrial Segment, to name a few. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sumedha. Morning, Mr. Ganayak, Mr. Dubey, Mr. Jayesh, Mr. Abhishek, Anant, Girja Shankar, and all my old colleagues. The topic which was assigned to me is the need and importance of energy efficiency for industry. But I will going to talk at a macro level. What is our commitment to the international community? What are our scheme? Where we have got the success and where we are not got, or maybe a failure case also. So before coming to the topic, because the title of this seminar is Energy Efficiency Dialogues Towards Sustainable Future. World Energy Institute has made the ranking of 120 countries on the three parameters. That is on energy security, energy access, energy diversity. India stands at a ranking of 109. And reasons are very actually because as far as our GDP growth rate and energy consumption is increasing, we are lacking in energy security. And particularly all the three major energy sources, that is coal, oil, and gas. If you can compare for last 30 years, the percentage share of all these fossil fuel energy, it is decreasing. The coal, which has got near about for 100 years reserve, but still today we are importing 200 million tons of coal. Oil, our dependency has reduced. Somewhere it was somewhere when the Bombay High was explored and we are projected. Today, we are already coming to 84-85% imported. And gas also, same problem. Now, what is right, going right actually for energy security is, yes, hydrocarbon exploration licensing help. But the problem is this also, the exploration of the natural gas, if you can see, it has reducing and our import is increasing. Yes, we have done a lot of good activities in the energy efficiency area. I can say, and major is industry and transport and agriculture and domestic. In transport sector, yes, what ESL is doing is promoting an electric vehicle. Yes, what we see in the future. But beside that also, government has done a lot of work actually, like the metro. If we can say like in Delhi, before 2000 and now today, 3 million people are traveling. And more than a dozen cities in India already, this metro is there. Major our energy, sustainable future also is not exactly the petrol, it is the diesel consumption with the transportation sector, particularly the trucks. We have already planned a dedicated corridor. Now, recently, last week only, the government of India has planned for 6 more dedicated corridor. By 2022, this northern India to the Bombay corridor will be ready. The sustainable future, see, if you can see, a truck carrying a load of, say, 20 ton from Ludhiana going up to the Kandla port, how much is the resource, how much the diesel, how much the repair, and how much is the CO2 emission, takes 1 week time, where this dedicated corridor will take only 1 week time, and is all driven by the electrical train. A dedicated line is there, so this is the future plan, but we have got the resource crunch, that's why these activities are little bit going at a slow pace. I appreciate, actually, I can tell about the ESL first thing, then coming to the Electricity Act and Energy Conservation Act. We are talking about the ESCO concept from 1987. The first time when World Bank has given the project to India to work out the energy service companies concept. But nothing has come, actually, for long and long. Only when this ESL was formed, problem with the ESCO actually is not that industry actually going for the energy efficiency is not that much bother about the financing. The scheme is attractive. They have got the resources. But now the, I can, because Mr. Ganayag has talked all the scheme which I am not going to cover. I am going to a unique scheme, which aggregation model the ESL has developed. See, the advantages of the ESCO mode by aggregation model, take the case of the compressor, which is already they have installed. Take the case of the regulated burner, all these schemes which is already launched and implemented, when you can go for the aggregation mode, like for motors, the compressor, which is the highest efficiency, which is not being manufactured. The aggregation mode means 35% reduction in the capital investment. Because this is the problem actually with the ESCO concept, when you can go to that, because industry ESCO model has not worked in our country so far. Only after going with the initiative for last 3-4 years, this model people are appreciating, but at a, because of the resources, because of the manpower, ESL is not moving in a vast thing. Huge demand is there. When the same best model is available at 35% less cost with a more efficient way, because one thing is there in industry, every industry people know what is the best equipment available in market. And what is their expectation when you can give the warranty, the service, and with that less cost of that, the way the aggregated model has worked out to reduce the cost of that equipment. So your project management cost can be born from that, the aggregation cost reduction part, which was lacking actually for most of the ESCO, which has empaneled in India because of so many reasons. But now this is already being done in this. Small 40% actually the energy cost. Actually, when we talk about the energy efficiency like this model, it is not you are reducing the energy cost. You are reducing operation and maintenance cost. You are reducing the, you're enhancing the life of that equipment. You are optimizing the process parameter by setting up an exact equipment. Under B Energy Conservation Act, yes. Demand side management, standard and labeling, ECBC, and now PAT, perform, achieve, and trade. Because I am concentrating for industrial sector only. Now, perform, achieve, and trade, it is working for last 10 years. First cycle, we have achieved 30 for 478 industry, large industry. We have achieved 32 million ton. CO2 emission reduction. Investment was somewhere 28,000 crore rupees by only 478 industries. PAT cycle completed last year, 623 industries. We have achieved near about 13 million ton oil equivalent saving, that is near 50, more than 50 million ton CO2. By investment was near about to 50,000 crore rupees. Now, with these 600-700 industries can invest so much in the energy efficiency efforts. But what the lesson we have learned actually, but now this is the high time that what we have done actually, the PAT, it is nothing. It is benchmarking energy indexing of the individual plant and comparing what is the bandwidth. Even in SMEs cluster, if the same exercise can be carried out and tell them, you are operating at this level, this is operating at that level, that will give a beautiful result. So energy security, yes, but what is going wrong in our country actually, this is really alarming. Our fossil fuel energy consumption will be doubled by 2040. What today we are consuming, it will be doubled. If you can see the parameters, coal, 820 million ton consumption, it is expected by 2022-23, it will be 1.76 million ton. oil. It is 220 million ton. It will be increased by 5% every year. And the problem with this, actually, we import $100 billion oil every year. And then you see our total export is hardly $320 billion. If the international price of oil is hardly $45, our export bill is $100 billion. With a CAGR of 5%, you expect how much will be there in the future. Another thing is coming our gas sector. No, in oil, I can tell you what is our reserve today. It can last only for 3 years' time. If we can annual consumption, if we can consume our own proven reserve oil, it will last. So for last few years, our indigenous production is decreasing. Our internal consumption is increasing. And that is also very alarming to energy security. Natural gas, it is going to rise threefold in next 10 years. And this is also why these are the very alarming thing. If you can just compare now Pakistan, and same condition we have in 1991, at that time when our foreign exchange reserve was hardly $500 million. We have kept 400 ton of gold in the London bank to get the loan, to make the repayment. Luckily, today we have got more than $500 billion foreign exchange reserve. That's why there is no problem. Otherwise, what happened in Pakistan recently, they have taken from the Saudi Arabia such type of thing. So this is the problem what we are facing today, actually in the energy security. Energy assets, yes. I think ministry has done this is a good job in last 20 years. In 2001-2, they have started how to reduce transmission and distribution losses. And if you can see in 2001, Delhi, it was a very good case study. Delhi, the losses was highest in India. It has crossed more than 50%. At that time, we used to compare Delhi power consumption and Bihar power consumption was same. Delhi per capita income is 5 to 6 times more than the Bihar per capita income. But Delhi transmission distribution losses are more than 50, where Bihar was 40. By going this for last AAP, DRP for last 20 years, today, at least we can say, now you see Delhi, which was more than 50% today, some circular 7-8% districts. And they want at least 12%. National target is 15%. Huge investment for reducing the transmission line losses, transformer. And because of all this thing, we are in a today position to give energy access, power for all, power to all villages, giving this barren land, putting up a solar plant for agriculture, and giving LPG by DBT mechanism. Because you cannot say our peak load is this much when you say 30 crore people, they do not have the power of cooking gas. So this is the area where we have done a good job. Coming to energy diversity. And this is a real problem what we are facing. Okay, we have planned only by 2020, 275 gigawatt solar and by 500 gigawatt by 2030. But what commitment we have given to the NDC? The commitment what we have given, 35% reduction in emission intensity. And what today, now I am talking about this commitment. There are two types of theories going on in the market. One is energy consumption. Like industry, we say this much percentage, building this much, agriculture this much, transport this much. The World Energy has forecasted global fossil fuel CO2 emission in 2017. I'm not talking about the energy, I'm talking about the CO2 emission from fossil fuel all over the world, total. 24% is coming from power sector. Industrial combustion is 28%. Household cooking and all is 3%. Transport is coming 21%. Others is coming 40%. So if we take only the CO2 emission from the power industrial combustion, it is somewhere 52%. And what in the UNFCCC document, their projected share of cumulative abatement of CO2 emission, 51% from energy efficiency and 32% from renewable. So what energy efficiency plays a much more important role than what we are at present doing for putting up our solar or wind and other aspects. Now this CO2 emission reduction, now at the last I will just tell, because already time, ESL has done a very good job. Actually, what I'm interested for the industrial segment, certain scheme it is implemented in large and SMEs also, and I can rely only in this institute. See, the ESCO mode, which has not, I think ESL can take in a big way. Community ESCO system for industrial cluster. What I mean actually in this, there's a life success story in Surat. And it has happened in Germany also, in France also, 25 textile mill. One private company has come, 25 textile mill. He has put up a community steam distribution system boiler. He has put up a 150 ton boiler. And 150 ton boiler, he is generating 15 megawatt cogeneration electricity. And from extraction, he is giving steam by meter to all the 25 industry. So this is the utility, and even chilled water can be also given to any industry which is required as a community system. Putting up a meter, see the how much abatement of the CO2 emission and improvement the energy efficiency can be achieved. Instead, you take 7% increase in boiler efficiency, 15 megawatt is free the electricity. What is the pollution level? What is the waste? And such type of system, I think in India there are near about 30-40 such type of cluster, and one can work out. I think this is the area where ESL can take. They are taking compressor, they are taking rice mill, they are taking in tea garden like modular burners, they are taking in the paper plant. I think such type of thinking also give, like what they are talking about, the tri-generation, co-generation, this will also work. Okay, sir. Sorry, I do not have any presentation. Only I want to speak about the need for energy efficiency for industrial segment. That's all. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. That was highly informative, and especially the solutions and problems India is facing in the energy sector and how energy efficiency is playing such an important role. Now we have with us Mr. Jayesh Goswami to present about the tri-generation programs of ESL. Mr. Jayesh has nearly 18 years of experience in reciprocating medium and high-speed gas engine-based power plant business for open cycle, combined cycle, and tri-generation. He has extensive experience in national and international sales and business development. Over to you, sir.
Is my screen visible to you?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Thanks. Good morning and welcome to everyone for this tri-generation presentation from the ESL. We'll talk about the ESL business model, ESL initiatives, some energy challenges which is being your experience in day-to-day our business things, energy challenges effects, dry generation and its concept, comparison between the conventional power and the dry generation, there's a transition process, we have some examples, there is a heat balance of dry generation, and some of the case studies which we have implemented successfully in India and globally. So as the ESL, which is a joint venture of the PSU, I think this all talks about our the previous speakers, Mr. Garnayak, so I'll not touch this thing. This is our ESL, the PACE model, which is a very innovative model wherein there is a no upfront investment to be done by the client, that is all done by the ESL. There is a very effective investment funding model where the equity and debt is 80 and 20, where our maximum equity return and is around 14% post tax. That will give the the best system in terms of the overall payback and the saving to the client. By innovative risk allocation, we do the procurement, installation and services for the maintenance, the complete the power plant or the water equipment is there. So these are the ESL initiatives where there is the energy efficiency business were there, where Mr. Karnak has explained about all detail in all the initiative. There is a clean energy business where the Trigenson is there, where we are we are representing. There is the green transportation. This all about that Mr. Karnak has discussed. So yeah, just the energy challenges we are facing day to day in our business and the industrial life. There are a lot of talks about the decarbonization. It is being increasingly discussed and accepted across the globe through the renewable sources, particularly for the energy. So, however, there is an issue in terms of the managing the variability or again its uncertainty. So we all about we know the solar or the wind power. There is a dependency from the environment. So there is a challenge in terms of decarbonization in this particular sector. There is centralized power station where the power is being produced away from the node center. So that is another issue. By doing this, definitely there is a loss of the transmission in terms of the delivering the power to the end user. There is a resilience, there's again a problem because of the proper the transmission line. Somewhere we have seen some industrial area, there is the power is available. At some section, for another section, the power is not available. So these are the energy challenges, which is, we are facing day to day. So there are effects on the business if there are challenges are there. There is the operational issue in terms of our business. So we lost our inventory, we lost our revenue in terms of finance. There is an increase in our energy cost. There is a drop in the other financial issues. There is a reputation issue in terms of if we are not able to supply the products or the services to the client because of the energy failures, there is a brand or reputational damages, and again there is a safety and compliance issue as well. So we have very innovative solution for the dry generation, wherein there is a single source of fuel which is being used, and from there we can straight away produce a three source of the high end energy. That is, one is the power that can be straight away used in the plant. There is a waste heat which is available from the engine or from the equipment, where can be we can install the heat recovery equipment like chill water or VAM or the boiler, and then we can generate this energy with the straight away, can be used without without using any fuel, in particularly from the waste heat. So it's a simultaneously the all the three heat which is which can be produced, and we can go up to the total system efficiency up to the 90% depending upon the application to application. But yes, most of the places where our efficiency is being achieved up to 85 to 86%. Yes, but this particularly application or this concept is only work when there is a 24/7 the application is there, like industrial park or some buildings or hospitals or some of the industries where there the operation is 24/7. So this is a comparison between the conventional power plant or the conventional way of generating the electricity and the thermal energy with a tri-generation. So this is small comparison where we put 100% fuel inside the power generating unit or the gas engine. We can straight away generate electricity in conversion of 44%. And there is the heat which is available in the jacket or the engine cooling and the exhaust heat that can be used for generating a steam or hot water or hot air. So total system efficiency, we can go up to 87%. If the same kind of efficiency or same kind of electricity and thermal, if we want to generate from the conventional power, we have to put almost 158% energy. So there is a straight away loss of more than 58% in terms of the input or the total of 71% losses. This is actually everybody knows, you know, we are, you know, we are wasting our resources in terms of the energy or the gas or coal is concerned. So opting the tri-generation whereby we can go up to the total system efficiency up to 87 or 90%. So this is a combination of tri-generation where we put air and gas inside the gas engine, generate electricity that can be straight away used in the plant. There is the heat which is available from the jacket cooling, so that can be tapped into the vapor absorption machine and we can generate a chilled water. The same, the exhaust, which is a hybrid heat, that can also be tapped into the waste heat recovery absorption chiller and we can generate a chilled water. So depending upon the client's requirement, maybe a 7 degree or 8 degree or 10 degree or even more, even 5 degree, 4 degree, that chilled water can be generated through the vapor absorption machine by using engine exhaust heat, which is the waste heat and the jacket heat. So this is a tri-generation heat balance. If you put 100% gas inside the engine, there is a comparison of the conversion of 44% in terms of electricity, 18% heat that can be rejected into the engine exhaust, and 20% in the engine jacket. So the electricity straight away can be used in the plant or the grid, wherever if you want to export into the grid, that can be straight away used in 450 volt or the 11 kV. There is a, from the exhaust heat, we can generate a steam up to 8 to 12 bar that can be straight away used inside the plant. There is a thermic fluid, like in textile industries or the other industries, packaging industries, they need a thermic fluid that can be also produced from the engine exhaust heat. Or the VAMP from the electric, from the chill water, we can go, we can, you know, generate chill water as well from 1 degree to 10 degree. The jacket heat is a low grade heat that can also be used in a waste heat recovery system. We can generate hot water for the process use, or we can put inside the VAMP and we can generate the chill water. So depending upon the application, whole the energy balance, we can go up to 85, 87, 88, 89%. So there is a around 18% or 17% are non-recoverable heat. There is a low-grade heat that cannot be recovered. So this is the total heat balance of how the tri-generation works. So the impact of the business sustainability, as it's today's our focus point on this today's webinar. So there is a low environmental impact. If we use a tri-generation, it will enhance the overall system efficiency. By opting this particularly concept, there is a cleaner path towards the sustainability. There is a cost reduction. Of course, there is a high efficiency in all our systems. It supports the carbon reduction footprint and go up to sustainability. If the sustainability achieved, we can straight away achieve the triple P system where the profit, people and planets are the main key pillar of the sustainability. So by opting the tri-generation, we can achieve or we can, you know, go up to the sustainability model. So there are potential business for the tri-generation, all the hotels, hospitals, airports, malls, industries, or district heating systems, district energy systems, residential, commercial complex, where this can be implemented. This tri-generation can be easily fit into all this kind of a business segment. Yes, there is an advantage in terms of cost saving, higher operating efficiency, reducing the electricity consumption, environmental friendly, buffering against the increased electricity cost, and reliable with a good quality in uninterrupted power. Some of the plants, they need a very high quality power in terms of their application is concerned. Some of the machines, they doesn't even allow small fluctuation in terms of the voltage. So where there is a precision works out there, the tri-generation can be the best fit solution for those industries. And again, there is a less dependency on the grid power. We have successfully implemented, or some of the it's being implemented in India and abroad for the tri-generation project. So in Mahindra and Mahindra, the project is on. It's an 800 kilowatt gas engine where we are generating 200 TR of heat chilling from the waste heat. And we are achieving around 80% total system efficiency. Another project, which is a data center project, same in Mumbai, where the 2000 kilowatt gas engine is being now, it's under progress. We are installing 450 TRs recovery VAM and 450 TR again, the fired VAM plus 3000 kVA DG set also we are going to install. Now in the data center, we have signed a SLA for the 99.4% availability guarantee. In particularly data center, they need a level 5, you know, the availability for their particularly business. So that kind of, you know, availability guarantee we have signed off with the client. And the project will be commissioned very soon, particularly in this, this data center. So this will be a very ideal, you know, the installation, and it will lead to the another business potential that will be open in future for the data center business. There are some overseas installation that's done by the our company Edina. So it is in UK, it's a 2 megawatt machine that is installed in the new Marion House, which is the commercial building. So that complete the CHP, you know, being you know, used in the particularly this this particularly building. There is a Portsmouth Naval Base, which is 13.5 megawatt CHP plant we have installed. And you can understand it's a very strategic location for the defense and naval base is concerned. So you can understand the criticality and the availability of the electricity and the chilling or the other the utility requirement. So that is you know, it's being delivered successfully to particularly at this location. There's a CityGen in the heart of London where 8.6 megawatt we have installed. So they are generating electricity and it is being used by the nearby all the residents, inhabitants, and the chilling or the heating which is being generated that again can be used because of it's a cold country. So they are using both the utility. When the summer is there, they use the chilling. When the winters comes, they use the heating. So that is a very successful installation. It is the heart of the London where this particular plant has installed. It gets heat. The council. It's again. They installed 4 megawatt machine there. Machine. The power is being generated and supplied to all the inhabitants in nearby the villages, and whatever heating is, you know, coming out, that again can be delivered and is being delivered to the all the homes. So it's a very it's like a district heating or cooling type installation that we have done in UK. That's the end of my presentation, and I would be happy to answer the question if you have any. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. And we will be taking all the questions at the end of the last presentation. And thank you for explaining the energy challenges and the process of tri-generation along with its benefits. Now I would like to invite Mr. Abhishek Dhupar, who's speaking about ESL National Motor Replacement Program. Mr. Abhishek has been working closely with ESL for National Motor Replacement Program since its inception, in developing the program framework by providing technical assistance and conducting market outreach activities. Currently at International Corporate Association India, he's heading Motors and Motor Driven System Program and is responsible for promoting energy efficient motors and pumps pan India. Over to you, sir.
Yes, is my screen visible?
Yes, it is.
Okay, right. So good afternoon, everyone. And I'll be presenting on National Motor Replacement Program. So I'll just remove this. Sumedha, is my PPT still visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, it is. Global energy consumption by end users, the slide which we can see.
But it has disappeared from my screen.
Just a minute, let me just check.
Is it fine now?
Yes, it's fine now.
Okay, great. So as everyone present here know that the share of motor driven systems in a industrial sector is basically huge, and as per the recent IEA 2016 outlook report, it suggests that 53% is the share of motors in an industrial sector. So hence there is a need that we improve the motor efficiency, thereby we improve the system efficiency by incorporating the premium efficiency motors available in the market nowadays. So for this, ESL has brought out a voluntary program. The need of this program obviously is, as you all know, that the present installation or the installed stock of the motors in the industries are basically of minimum I1 or lower than that level. So what happens is that when you try to upgrade this system to I2, as Mr. Ganayak told in the morning, is now the minimum energy performance standard. And this was notified by Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion under Commerce Industry. This was notified in 2018. So ESL thought that a voluntary program for I3 will give a fillip to the energy efficiency in motors, that people can directly go for I3 instead of going to I2 when they replace their I1 or below motors. And this will attract the price reduction and other features which will be beneficial for the industry to directly leapfrog to I3. So hence this program was rolled out, and a lot of thinking and brainstorming has gone behind this program. So there might be a question that why not I4 and why I3? Why did not ESL bring up with a I4 program? So to explain that, basically I4 motors are generally currently in the market not available in the complete range. So that is one of the roadblocks. The other roadblock is because of variation in the technology. Till I3 it was induction motors, and from I4 onwards it is basically more than induction motor. It also uses PMSM, which is a permanent magnet synchronous motor. Also we have switch reluctance motors. So again, because of variation in technology and other investments required in VFDs, switchgear, etc., retrofitting with I4 poses a huge challenge. So that is one way where the user needs to understand that, should I go with I4 for retrofitting, or should I go with I4 for new installations, basically a new assembly line, new plant coming up. So we can take this further in Q&A session. Now coming on to what are the improvements when you compare an I1 motor or below I1 motor with I3. So you can see in these smaller motor ranges, the efficiency improves from, to give you an example of a 2.2 kilowatt, you can see it improves from 79.7% to 86.7%. While in the larger motors, if you see, let's say we take a 55 kilowatt motor, then it improves by, let's say, a 2.5%. Now, in bigger motors, the efficiency improvement is less, but the quantum of energy consumed is more. So hence, users which can put that kind of investment should go for replacing higher size motors. But for the smaller size or the mid size, what we can do is, because it attracts low investment and are cheaper, so basically we can go for smaller motors because the efficiency improvement is more. So this has to be balanced. So this brings us to what should be the approach for replacement. So the user has a dilemma in mind that whenever I want to change my motor, which motor should I target first and then move ahead. So this is few pointers which I have placed on screen, that the initial thing should be to target motors which are at least 10 to 15 years old, because there will be loss in efficiency in these motors to a larger extent as compared to the new ones. Also, when we talk about rewinding, the older motors tend to be rewound at least 2 to 3 times minimum. So with each rewinding, as per a Bureau of Energy Efficiency study, there is a drop of close to 1%. So with this drop, you can say that initially a 10-year-old motor was, let's say, working at 85% efficiency. So after 3 rewinds, it has come down to 82%. So that is also one of the requirement that why you should replace a rewounded motors after 2 rewinds. So that is one of the very major consideration the industry should see to it. And coming on to the operating hours and motor loading, obviously the more the motors are run, for the larger period the motors are run, the payback will be lower. So hence you should ideally go for motors which are running for 2 shifts, 3 shifts. And for loading, obviously if the motors are underloaded or loaded less than, let's say, 60-65%, then there is a need to understand that whether we should correct size the motors or we should keep it running, because if we replace it with an i3 i4 motor, again the payback will be high because these motors are not sufficiently loaded. So these are few points which should be kept in mind before sharing the inventory with ESL or before buying the motors even from the market, etc. Now coming to the electric motor driven system, so when we change or retrofit a electric motor in the system, we need to understand that the approach should be a holistic approach. Now even if you replace a electric motor, your efficiency of the motor will improve as compared to the old one, maybe by 7 to 8%. But when you look at the overall system efficiency, it will improve only by 4-4.5%, 5% maybe, because it has many other components which are playing a key role. So for example, when you couple a motor with a driven application, so now this driven equipment can be any centrifugal load or a variable torque application like pump, fan, compressor, blower, etc. But at the same time, the coupling also plays an important role, that whether these are coupled through a gearbox or through a VFD or through a belt pulley system or directly coupled. So again, their efficiencies also play a certain role, or their role is that how you can match the load RPM of the electric motor so that you can generate savings. So there is a need, I request users to understand this and then go for a replacement to get larger savings, higher savings. Now to validate the savings, deemed savings model which Garnaik GS presented, that ESL runs on, we conducted pilot studies for 40 numbers i3 motors at various clusters, various sectors, which had automotive, textile, brass, chemical. So you can see the savings which we could get by doing this energy audits were in the range of 10 to 16% for various applications like pump processing machines, compressors, fan blowers, etc. Now all these audits were done by reputed agencies like Terry, Ace Enablers, Power Tech Engineers, so CD Exergy, and all these reports are there with ESL to have an understanding that how or what kind of savings can be achieved by retrofitting an old motor with i3. So this is to give you a fair idea how the NMRP model operates. So ESL basically acts as a administrator who does the coordination with the manufacturers and the client. So ESL rolls out a competitive bidding in the market where all the lead manufacturers like Siemens, ABB, Crompton, Bharat Bijli, they all participate. And once the price is received by ESL, which is lower than the market, and other value add features which ESL puts in its RFP, so this price is then shared by the industries, whosoever is basically interested in the program, whosoever is sharing the inventory with the ESL. ESL also employs certain kind of demand aggregators and outreach agencies who basically help ESL in propagating this program to the end users. So that is one way of doing the demand aggregation. The other is direct contact with the industry. And industry, once after buying the motors, has a flexibility between two payment models and it can repay to ESL accordingly. So So all this is done by ESL, and the entire project monitoring is done by ESL. Now coming on to the technical details, I know all of you present here will be having in mind that which motors are considered under this program. So these motors are basically safe area motors and not hazardous area motors which are flame proof, etc. So ESL program is currently for safe area motors, which is squirrel cage induction motor, and these all motors are adhering to efficiency class I3, and this is all the technical specification performance values are strictly according to IS 12615 and IEC 60034. So you don't have to worry about the quality or the performance of the motor. It is thoroughly taken care of during the RFP or the bidding, before the bidding itself. And we, with respect to the range of kilowatt or HP, these are basically ranging from 0.75 kilowatt to 75 kilowatt, or you can say 1 HP to 100 HP. These motors are covered under this program for all the polarities, both fort and flange mountings. And also there are some value add features provided by ESL, like these motors are VFD compatible by default. So even if today you are not using a VFD and plan to use a VFD after 3 years, you don't have to worry about it. The other part is when you use a VFD for larger size motors, again, there are some issues of bearing current, shaft currents to come up because of certain peak or fluctuations. So at that time, the role of insulated bearing comes into picture, and hence ESL has taken care of that also and provided insulated bearing for the large size motors also. Also, there are requirement by the users of re-greasing the motor after a certain period of time. So let's say if your bearing after a work of 30,000 or 40,000 hours, the lubrication reduces. So you can, without stopping the motor through grease nipples, you can basically re-grease it. So all these good technical features have been incorporated in the motor to take care of the user requirements. Now coming on to why ESL and why not take it directly from the motor manufacturer or their channel partner dealers, etc. So ESL offers you a price which is lower than the market retail price. Also, it includes the value add features or the technical features which I've told you. Also, this provide is inclusive of the extended warranty. By extended warranty, I don't mean that after first year you have to pay for the other 2-3 years. It is the complete 3 year warranty which has been taken care of in the same price itself. When you take it from the market, you get around 1-1.5 year of warranty, but ESL will provide you 3 years warranty. And all the reputed brands of motors are offered by ESL phase wise. So in the first phase, we were offering Crompton, Bharat Bijli, Siemens, LHP. In the second phase, we were providing Rotomotive also. Now in the third phase, we are basically providing you Siemens and ABB motors for this year. So accordingly, the customers can send their inventory to us. And also there are certain other unique features of ESL that all these prices are FOR prices, FOR basis. So you don't have to worry for the transportation. The repayment options are of two types. One is you repay upfront. Other is the entire investment is made by ESL, which comes under the ESCO mode as told by the previous speakers. So there the customer can basically pay, repay in different installments for next 3 years, that too quarterly and not monthly. So that is a very good headache which can be taken care of by this model. And apart from that, if you take it on a large quantity, let's say 100 numbers and above, ESL also provides value addition support like monitoring and verification on a sample basis. We can also provide some kind of technical training on the maintenance and operation, or the something else with respect to motors, etc., for the maintenance teams. So all these features are there. Now coming on to the business models, which has already been told by, I think some issue. Yeah, already being told by Mr. Ganai that there are two models, and specifically with the second model, if I tell that you have an option to basically repay the entire thing in a deferred manner. So you can take all, let's say, 100 motors in one shot and then install them, start getting the savings from day one, and from those savings you start repaying it for next three years. And also those payment does not have to be monthly, it can be quarterly. So this is the best feature of this, that no collateral is being required by ESL apart from one bank guarantee. The other issues of credit rating, etc., are not there. Balance sheet, all those things does not need to be shared by the user to ESL. So just to give you a fair idea, if we take a case of 25 motors of various sizes, various ratings, various quantity, so you see the calculated energy savings annually are 69,675 rupees, units. So this is how I'll explain the entire model, that these energy savings when multiplied with the your grid power cost will show you the annual cost savings. Now these annual cost savings is basically from which in the ESCO mode you repay your installments. So if you see serial number 5, the capital cost of motors is the cost of the material or the motor which has been received from the tender by opening the tender. So that actual cost is being shared with the user, and on that no extra marking has been done. Only there is a ESL project management fee of a nominal percentage which is being charged on it, and that comes up to your serial number 7, which is the project cost. Now as you can see in the PMC model, because the user is directly buying the motors and paying to ESL within a month, so that comes out to be the total project cost and nothing else is added in there. But in the ESCO mode, you can see that there is a finance cost of around 2 lakh rupees which gets added for these 25 number motors, and hence your project cost comes out to be 10,49,000. Now this 10 lakhs, as you can see in the subsequent rows below, you see you are repaying it in 12 quarters, and these savings per quarter, I mean these repayment per quarter, is coming out from your annual cost savings which was mentioned in the serial number 4. So hence what happens is the share of cost savings to ESL comes out to be 71%, 72% around. So 72% of the savings you are paying to ESL, while the balance is being enjoyed by the user from day one. So this is how the proposal is structured and the model is structured and shared with the user. In some cases it might happen that user, either the tariff cost is very low or the number of running hours are very low, hence ESCO mode might not be feasible, but in most of the cases, 95% of the cases, we offer both the models for the users. So this is just a pictorial representation. I'll just skip it to save the time. This is an actual case study of the implementation which has been done by ESL in various plants. So this is one of the fertilizer plant in Cochin, where you can see that around 124 numbers were procured by the customer under the ESCO mode, where it was a zero capital investment by the customer. And the calculations, these calculations have been shared by the user itself. So they purchased around 9 ratings of different sizes, and you can see the net present value of the project is always positive for all the quarters, for the 12 quarters, as you can see in the graph. So the benefit for the user is that for taking the approval from management, they can show that, see, if we would have taken from the market, we would have paid beforehand, and the savings or the payback period would have come somewhere around the 10th quarter, and after that the project would have come in the positive stage. While in the ESCO mode, because it is happening in such a manner that from the cost savings itself you are repaying it, hence your NPV remains positive for the net present value remains positive for the entire project period. So here you can see the user, I basically the industry ended up saving 3.4 lakh units at a total investment of 44 lakhs and could achieve a cost savings of 19.2 lakhs annually. So you can see in next 3 years, by the time the project gets over, he will already be achieving more than the investments, and hence the payback will come out to somewhere around 2.3 years. Apart from that, carbon emission reduction, the improvement in motor efficiency, in the vibration, noise, power factor improvement, many things are there which the user gets benefited from. So the key takeaways here is that the, as I told you, that the shared savings approach was here 79% to 21%, while the entire upfront investment was done by ESL, so no investment had to be done by FACT upfront, while at the same time there was an improvement in motor and system efficiency. As you can see, at the same time there was reduction in the bearing temperature and the vibrations level of the motor. So all this was a huge benefit for this customer, and they in fact presented their case study during the CII Energy Circle competition and have received the award for the best case study in motors. So just to conclude, this is our online web portal where the users can go understand more about the program, refer to some case studies, refer to some skiing brochures, and at the same time log in and provide their motor details so that ESL can immediately furnish a proposal to you. It can also be done offline if you email it to us, email your requirement to us. So both the options are available, online, offline, as it suits you. This is the last slide. Here we are just explaining how you can get in touch with us and what the process is for the NMRP. So basically, once we receive your inquiry either from email or from the web portal, we submit a proposal to the client. When the client discusses with ESL and rules out all the doubts in their mind, then the letter of acceptance is provided by a client through email or through hard copy that they are willing to go ahead. If it is a PMC mode, directly formal PO can be given to the given to ESL by the client. But in case of ESCO mode, there is a agreement signing required where we finalize all the terms and conditions with you, and post that the PO is received from the customer, and then the supplier starts the manufacturing in next 1 month. So the delivery time here is around close to 30 to 45 days, which is at present the normal tenure as compared to I3 motors. And again, the repayment, if it is a PMC mode, has to be made within 30 days. But in case of an ESCO mode, you can pay it in 2-3 years as the proposal or the mutual agreement has been done. And then the project closure is there. So thank you, everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Abhishek, for sharing those unique features of the motor program and the success story. Moving on, I would like to invite my last speaker for today's webinar, Dr. Anand Shukla, to speak about ESL's super efficient AC programs for buildings and industry. At present, Dr. Anand is working with ESL as additional general manager and leads many flagship programs such as super efficient air conditioner, district energy system in cities, and JEF supported activities and programs. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sumedha. Can you see my screen?
We can, but we cannot see the presentation yet.
Okay. So.
Yeah, we can.
Okay, I think I switched something else. So let me, how do I end it? Yeah.
Anand, can you please upload the presentation for Dr. Anand?
Thank you, Sumedha.
Sure.
Is it coming or?
Yeah, I think Anant is just uploading. Maybe you can begin and the presentation will come within the next 2 minutes.
Okay, so basically, yes, I think that was a good idea. So sometimes, you know, it's good also to present at the very last, at the end of the session, because you don't have to speak too much and you can directly jump on the, you know, main crux of the discussion points. So in this session, actually, I will speak about super efficient air conditioners, because already the motors has created a lot of heat in the environment. So I have to cool it from a super efficient air conditioner. So basically, I will be talking about, thanks Anant and Sumedha. So I can see the presentation now. So in this session, I will talk about the super efficient air conditioner program of EESL, and also give you some facts about why we are doing this program and set a context. Although my colleagues have spoken about it, but let me, for the sake of the today's presentation, speak about the background why we are doing this super efficient air conditioner program at ESL. So can you please display the first slide, Anand? Okay, so maybe the next one. The second slide. Second slide.
I think there's some time lapse between the slides.
Sorry? Yeah.
Just a minute.
So anyways, I think if, So actually in today's discussion, most of the colleagues are from industries and commercial sector. But I think you all know about the air conditioning requirement in industries, and you know, air conditioning is not only required for human comfort but also for the productivity, and this is also linked to sustainable development goals. So in this today's presentation, I will talk about the global and national scenario where India stands, then briefly talk about Bureau of Energy Efficiency Standard and Labeling Program, and this is also important in today's presentation, because then that will also set a stage for the super efficient air conditioners which we are deploying in Energy Efficiency Services Limited. And then very end of the presentation, I will talk about the program itself, and then conclusion and way forward, I will talk about what major clients we have in the air conditioning program. So maybe we go to the third slide. The next slide, please. So from the upcoming slide, yes, this slide, you will see that the temperatures are rising. And you know, previously we used to have more cold weather, but because of, you know, human activity and, you know, industrialization, commercialization, the temperatures are rising, and we are now facing more, you know, hot weather compared to you know, couple of decades earlier. So the as the curve is shifting more towards the right, which is, you know, the higher temperatures, so this will also increase the demand of air conditioning, because we need more and more air conditioning space. For example, I give an example to you. Last, I think 10 days back, there was very severe hot weather in California desert, and the temperatures went up to 55 degrees centigrade, and that happened in several decades. So, you know, these kind of situations are happening more and more frequently, and we need more and more air conditioning. But simply, you know, requiring an air conditioner will not solve the purpose, because it's like cat and mouse. If you bring a cat to kill the mouse, then you will need another, you know, dogs, because then, you know, this cycle will keep on continuing. So there is a need to analyze what we need to do so that both the objectives are met. For example, the temperature rise is kept in control, and also we parallelly meet our demand or a need for air conditioning. Maybe we go to the next slide, please. So that is where air conditioning is very important. And when it comes to air conditioning, it is also important to see where do we stand. So from this present slide, you will see that, you know, the per capita cooling energy consumption in United States is highest among all the, you know, nine countries I have listed down here. And then second comes Japan, then Japan, Middle East, China, European Union, and then India is at the very lowest level. So this does not mean that it is bad, but this is also an indicator that this curve, which is standing at 69 kilowatt hour per person per annum, this is set to grow. And when this curve grows, this also will result into increased in total primary energy requirement. And India is a big country, and we have limited resources when it comes to coal, thermal, hydro, and also renewable energy cannot be deployed rate where that matches the demand. So we need to do something. So to address this situation, can you go to the next slide, please? The next slide, yeah. Sorry, not this one. The next one. Next slide, please.
I think there is some lag.
Okay, I do not see the slide. So maybe I think so by the time the slide comes, because in a nutshell, in the years to come, the number of air conditioners, they will rise from whatever a number of air conditioners we have today will go up to 1.2 billion. No, not this one, the previous one. It will go to 1.2 billion, and that will be the 4.5 times or 5 times until 2050. This number I am talking about global increase in the number of air conditioners. And the grow in the air conditioning space will also result in emissions. So the emission will also double, almost double by 2050 over 2017 levels, which we have. And there is a need switch to more clean and efficient cooling. And this also will need a lot of investment, and wherein the role of EESL comes into picture. And lastly also, if we keep on using this the efficiency levels as we have today, this will also put a burden of 12 gigatons of CO2 emissions by 2050. So to address all these challenges, the India Cooling Action Plan was launched in March 2019, and this I have taken three objectives from this India Cooling Action Plan, which directly links to the super efficient air conditioner or the air conditioning sector as such. So this India Cooling Action Plan talks about reduction in the cooling demand by up to 20% by 2038. So basically, this cooling action plan was developed taking into consideration the 2 decades horizon. And this also talks about reduction in refrigerant demand, because when it comes to environment, when it comes to an ozone layer and the negative impacts it might create, so this also focuses on the reduction in the refrigerant demand. That's it. That is also between 25% to 40% in the next couple of years. And how do we address these two is also related to the trained manpower, to the technicians, those are visiting your places, be it a residential customer or an industrial or a commercial premises. All the three are equally important. So maybe the next slide, please. So the super efficient air conditioner program addresses all the three objectives. And we also did a study to analyze what is the air conditioning market in India. And next slide, please. Next slide. I don't know. Or maybe better would be if I become a presenter. I don't know. So anyways, so we also conducted a study last year, and according to the study, the AC penetration in India is around 6%, as you already know from the graph which I have shown at the very beginning. And this 6%, out of this 6%, 60% of the air conditioners are 3-star air conditioners. And this 6% market, not this one, the previous one, I think you are jumping slides. So I will speak. So, the present AC market in India is only 6%. And out of this 6%, 60% of air conditioners are 3-star air conditioners. And this 6% market, if I give it in absolute number terms, this is around 8 million units per year. So basically, what I want to say is around 80 lakh units are sold in India per year. and in the next two decades this will grow. So so by the time 2038, around 4 crore units of air conditioners will be sold in India per year. So this will be a big number, and this will also impact negatively on the total primary energy supply. So to cater to this demand, the present 60 million tons of oil equivalent total primary energy supply will rise to 260 million tons of oil equivalent in the next 20 years. So and this is also highlighted in the graph which is displayed on the screen. So you see from 2017-18 to 2037-38, so until next year, until the end of next decade, until 2027 to 2038, the rise in air conditioning space will slow, will gradually increase. However, in the second decade, from 2027 to 2028 onwards, the rise in the demand for space cooling will grow at a very faster rate. So an action has to be taken today. And if you go to the next slide, please. And this demand, increasing demand will also result into increasing, projected increasing demand in the cooling. So in terms of 1000 gigawatt hours, we will also see, we can see that the demand for total primary energy supply for all these applications which is related to cooling, not only air conditioning, will also rise, and this will be around 1000 terawatt hours by 2037 to 2038. So there is a need to switch to next slide, please, switch to more efficient products. And when it comes to more efficient products, you see, whenever you want to buy an air conditioner, you would like to know which is the most efficient air conditioner, and that also fits your pocket. So if you see that, you know, the recent star rating program talks about, you know, the most efficient product starts, which is five star product, starts from 4.5 ISEER. ISEER is Indian Seasonal Energy Efficiency Ratio, and the highest efficient air conditioner starts from 4.5, and this I am talking about the split air conditioner, and this is called, you know, five star air conditioners. So maybe next slide, please. Maybe next one. Yes. So to address this demand, to address this challenge, what was the challenge? The challenge was to provide a five star air conditioner at the price of almost at the price of three star air conditioner, so that more and more people can switch from three star to five star with a little, very minimal burden on their pockets. So we launched a super efficient air conditioner program last year in July 2019, and the program partners were United Nations Environment and Asian Development Bank under the Global Environment Facility. So we launched an international bidding, and Voltas was the winner, and then finally, after identifying an OEM, we launched this program in July 2019. Next slide, please. So we launched the super efficient air conditioner program, and the salient features of this air conditioner was that it was not only a five star product, but also the best in five star air conditioners. So if you see from this slide, the ISEER value of this air conditioner is 5.4 as against the 4.5 ISEER value of the base five star air conditioner. So next slide, please. So we launched this program, keeping in mind that this was launched for retail customers, and we then slowly rolled it out to institutional customers. And next slide, please. And when it comes to, you know, the savings, we also wanted to sensitize people, like if they spend very little more on five star product, how much of saving they will incur per day or per annum or per month in terms of energy and in terms of monetary benefits because of higher energy efficiency. So this calculator, which is available on the website www.eeslmart.in, gives an indicator how much of energy this five-star AC or super efficient five-star AC would save. And you can see, you can choose whether it is a replacement air conditioner and you are replacing with a window. And also you can see how many hours per day you use and how many hours you operate per month. And then you can simply hit the calculate button and you will see the tentative savings you will incur from this super efficient air conditioner. So next slide, please. So when it comes to institutional and commercial customer, quite often we face the question that how you have already mentioned that it will save around 30-35% saving, but have you done some pilot activity? So then we have conducted a pilot also as soon as the program was launched. So we conducted this pilot using a IECR 5.2 air conditioner. And you see from the curve that on the shaded part, the per day energy consumption has gone below 31.6. So there is a saving of 31.6% kilowatt hours. That is around somewhere between 5 to 6 kilowatt hour per day. And if you multiply this by per annum and then further by the electricity tariff, that would be the amount of energy and money you would be saving by upgrading to a super efficient air conditioner. So this study we did using a 1 TR air conditioner and IACR value of 5.2 TR. And what we are talking today is IACR 5.4, which is even more efficient. So the savings from this air conditioner 5.4 will be even higher. Next slide, please. So when it comes to, you know, deploying the air conditioner, the next challenge was how to deploy these air conditioner to retail and institutional customers. So for retail customer, we have developed a website, as already I have mentioned, that eeslmart.in is the website. And then customer can order the air conditioner, and the air conditioners are delivered between 3 to 7 days. And in case there are some inquiry related to the product as well as about scheme, the customer can call on these numbers as well as send an email to us. However, when it comes to institutional customer or a commercial customer, can we go to the next slide, please? The queries can be raised through the email address or through our state and corporate offices all over the country. And then we submit a proposal and clients make the payment, and then we start the delivery of the air conditioners. And we also ensure that the old air conditioners are bought back from the customer, depends on the choice of the customer, so that once we buy back the air conditioner, we safely dispose of the e-waste and the refrigerant used in the old air conditioners, and then also produce a green certificate. We take it from our e-waste recycling agency. So that is actually a very brief overview on the air conditioner program. Next slide, please. And perhaps this is the last slide which I would like to discuss. And some of the key and the main customers we have are HDFC Bank, NTPC, Mahindra, Central Electrical Electronics Limited, IIIT Allahabad, REC, Punjab Energy Development Agency, and many more such organizations. And till date, as Mr. Garnaik has mentioned, that we have deployed more than 2,000 air conditioners in the past 1 year, and more orders we are received every day. So that is all I would like to mention in today's presentation, and open to any questions you might have, so that we can provide more insight into the air conditioner program. So next slide, and I think then that is the end of my presentation. In case if you have queries, you please feel free to send an email to me, and also you may like to call on my telephone number, and we will be happy to provide further information or any query you might have.
Thank you, Dr. Anand, for explaining the program and telling us very interesting energy saving calculator and the case studies. So now moving on, we have quite a few questions from our audience here. So I'll read out the questions and then the panelists can answer them. So the first question we have here is, what are the benefits of cogeneration, trigeneration for IT and banking complexes? We do not have any production line or any byproducts, heat or flue gases. So if Mr. Jayesh can answer this.
बहुत सारे जवाब मिल जाएंगे.
इसको आप मंगेश को लगाओ. मंगेश क्या कर रहा है?
वो भी कर रहा है ना ये.
हेलो.
गैस की इसने डिटेल दे रखी है.
सर मुझे मंगेश को उसमें लगाया था.
मिस्टर जयेश. Okay, maybe I'll move on to the next question. We can come back to this one. So the next question we have is, is the ESCO model implementation available for the AC program? And what is the minimum project size for being eligible for this program?
So, Dr. Anand, thanks, Ameda. This is an interesting question. Actually, the ESCO model is available for air conditioner program. And minimum size we expect is like at least 100 air conditioners are advisable. However, we are also open to look into the detail. And this also depends equally on the client, what kind of, repayment period they would like to choose. Because, when it comes to ESCO mode, as already have mentioned earlier, that this will also include the PMC charges of ESL and also bring in the interest component. So this equally depends on the client, whether the client is available to take on the additional financial burden that can be worked together with the clients.
Okay, thank you for that answer, Dr. Anand. The next question, Mr. Abhishek will be able to answer this. So the size of the motor present and offered by ESL, is the cost exclusive of all the civil work?
Yes, so the National Motor Replacement Program basically includes the material cost and the transportation cost. It does not include the cost of installation, because what happens is the installation for motors as the business as usual scenario, if you see, it is done by the plant maintenance team itself. Even if ESL tries to undertake this activity, what happens is that every user has their shutdown done accordingly. So it cannot be that in one day ESL plans to change, let's say, 100 motors, but the customer will never be ready to do so. So it becomes a complex situation for ESL also, that how to undertake the replacement activity and take shutdowns every now and then.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Abhishek, for that. The second question is again for you. Who are the eligible entities under the National Motor Replacement Program?
So any unit, any industry, be it small, medium, large enterprise, anyone, can basically replace their old motors or buy new motors from us. It is actually not for any kind of a intermediary as of now. Let's say any channel partner or so will not be entertained, but it is definitely for the industries.
Okay, now this question is for both the AC and the motor program. How would the savings be monitored in both these programs?
For the air conditioner program, what we do is we estimate the savings based on the the baseline energy consumption. So there is no monitoring as such, online real-time monitoring as far as the air conditioner program is concerned. What we do is we estimate the savings based on the existing air conditioners, and in case there are no air conditioners installed or deployed at site, we just make the estimation based on the intended purchase of the buyer. There is no real-time monitoring as such. And as I have already mentioned, that we have already conducted a pilot at one of the ATMs, and this has resulted in more than 31.6% saving. So that is something which we can confidently convey. And with IACR 5.4, this will be even higher. And just one more thing, we are also conducting a pilot for HDFC Bank at 10 ATMs in Delhi and Mumbai. And just to assure that this is the savings which they would incur. So what we can do is we can show it based on the actual data and prove that this will be the saving. However, there will be no monitoring, online remote monitoring for the air conditioners. Yes, if the customer wants to do it, they can put up a meter and then they can monitor on their own. But that will be not be possible for air conditioner program. Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Abhishek, if you can answer the same question for the motor program.
Right. So
how the savings will be monitored?
Yeah. So as I presented during the session that the model, NMRP model, is also based on deemed savings approach. Now, the first question comes up, why deemed savings and why not actual savings? So somewhat the issue has also been highlighted by Dr. Anand Shukla also, that what happens is, even in case of motors, there are n number of parameters which will affect your energy consumption. So you have removed the old motor from the system, now you have put a new motor. Again, the consumption will vary upon your loading percentage every day, every month, every year. Similarly, the driven equipment, whether it is again 10 years, 15 years old, or whether it was purchased only a year ago. Similarly, the efficiency of your belt pulley, the efficiency of your couplings, the other things, if you're driving from VFD, how you are using it. So many things are there, which ESL sitting outside cannot predict and will not be able to do so. So if you have to do a continuous monitoring of energy savings, you will have to install some kind of energy meters for the large size motors. Small motors, they are not feasible for large size motors. Also, maybe ESL can help you in doing on a sample basis, a energy saving M&V audit. But it will only happen if you are buying it in bulk quantity, and ESL can do, let's say, for a 10% of the sample, the M&V for you as a learning thing, so that you can implement for the entire set of motors at your end.
Okay, thank you. Another question we have is, do you have an energy efficient server cooling solutions for IT firms? So I think that's an open question.
Sumedha, can you repeat the question?
Do you have energy efficient server cooling solutions for IT?
I think this depends on how much of the load, cooling load is, how big is the server facility is. So let me answer this question step by step. If it is a small server room, then of course we can deploy super efficient air conditioner in the server room. And if it is, let's say, of a middle size and middle to big size, then there are two options. We are developing a national chiller efficiency program, and this talks about deploying super efficient chillers in the premises. And in case there is a waste heat available around, then trigeneration can also be deployed in the server. So basically, as my colleague Mr. Goswami, he mentioned about, you know, a big project he is leading is with IT a data center in Mumbai. So this is, you know, we have all the solutions, and we can together discuss based on the raw data we will receive from you. I hope
Thank
I answered
this. Yes, I think you answered it very well. In fact, they've mentioned data center also, so that's great. The next one we have, can you provide information about the pulp and paper industry and if any company has taken the motor replacement scheme benefit for pulp and paper industry? Mr. Abhishek, if you can answer.
Yes, definitely it has been done. We have done it with Sesahai Paper Board in South, and also we have done with ITC Paper and Packaging Industry. So both these companies, ITC, as you know, is a very big giant, has done it. At the same time, we have done it with Sesai Paper Board. So, and it has been done on both the models. So ITC has taken it on PMC, while SPB has taken it on ESCO mode. So if required, we can get in touch with you and explain further.
Okay, thank you. We have a question on the AC program. How reliable are the ACs in the long run, and how many years of warranty do we get on these ACs?
Let me answer the first part of this question about reliability. When it comes to reliability, I would like to mention that most of the compressors in air conditioner, it's like, you know, if you buy a car, then the engine is, you know, there are few manufacturers who manufacture engine. So the main component of an air conditioner is the compressor. And most of the compressors are manufactured by, you know, selected manufacturing, you know, units in India, and also most of the compressors are imported. So when it comes to the reliability, the air conditioners is at par with any air conditioners available in the India market, and this is as reliable as other brands available in the Indian market, because the main component is the compressor and the fans which are deployed in the indoor unit. And the second question about the warranty. So the warranty varies from a retail customer to industrial or commercial customer. This is because the hours of operation and the you know, the field conditions are vary from retail to industrial or commercial customer. So for retail customer, the warranties for the overall unit and the compressor are 5 year and 10 year respectively. However, for the institutional or commercial customer, those warranties are 1 year and 5 year. Let me also give a brief elaboration on the warranty when it comes to institutional consumer or customer, that we also offer a very comprehensive and competitive comprehensive AMC that can range from 1 year to 5 years. And those are, you know, at par or above par when it comes to our competitors in the market. So I hope I answered this question. And in case, you know, if further information is required about the rates and how we do it, I will be open to discuss on that.
So for the AC program, we have another question. What is the minimum project size for being eligible for this program?
I would say if you have 1 year conditioner demand, that is also fine with us. Because we have, as I mentioned, that we started this program from retail customer. So there is no minimum. But yes, when it comes to ESCO mode, we would like to have at least minimum number so that the it becomes financially viable and also attractive for you to take a decision. Otherwise, there is no minimum requirement. If you want one AC in your factory premises, we will be happy to support you.
Okay, great. So the last question again is for the AC program. Is the output efficiency calculated for the ACs? If yes, how efficient are they in terms of the output efficiency?
So basically, I would say I would not go into, you know, the efficiency of an individual component. So or output or input. What I would say is here is, just to make it simple, you know, the Bureau of Energy Efficiency is providing the, you know, the logo on the air conditioner. So they are ensuring that whatever claims we make on the product, let's say ISER value of 5.4, Indian Seasonal Energy Efficiency value, those are, you know, checked by the manufacturer in their labs, testing labs, and those are also surprise checked by the Bureau of Energy Efficiency. Let me also tell you that we also got these air conditioners checked in our presence in one of the labs in New Delhi. And we found that these air conditioners are more efficient than what we claim. So the ISER value was even higher than 5.4. So I would say let's go by the ISER value and also if you want to estimate what would be the energy and economic saving, then that is a different matter. And that if you talk about those numbers, then the energy consumption per day per annum comes into picture. So those values also we have with us, and we will be happy to work out on a techno-economic viability.
Thank you, Dr. Anand. I think we have with us Mr. Jayesh again. So I'll just take the last tri-generation question. So someone's asking, what are the benefits of tri-generation for IT and banking complexes? We do not have any production line or any byproducts, heat or flue gases.
Yeah, actually in banking or the IT industries where there is a lot of cooling load is there. So the cooling load is almost more than 60-70% of the normal lighting or the other load. So where we can install a dry generation and we can balance the electricity and the cooling load in a such a way that we can utilize the waste heat from the gas engine and convert that heat into the cooling. And we can, you know, balancing whole the heating and the electricity demand. So it's a case to case where that required an in-depth study for particularly that building. And then we can offer the particular that solution. Like I explained about the data center in Mumbai, where we are going to install a 2 megawatt gas engine. So the electricity that will be generated through the engine that will be straight away used in their data center where the electricity is required. From the server cooling, the whatever heat is coming out will install the VAM, generate 450 TR of chilled water, and that will be used in the server cooling. So again, it's required a detailed in-depth study, feasibility study, technical study, and then that, you know, the solution can be then configured according to the requirement. So we would be, you know, happy to, you know, take all the information from whoever is there, and then we can submit our the solution to them.
Okay, thank you. Another one for you, Mr. Jayesh. Minimum size of tri generation system which can be used. What is the minimum size?
800 kilowatt. If we install a 800 kilowatt of gas engine, in Mahindra and Mahindra in Mumbai where we have installed, so that can be installed, and 200 tons of chilling. That is the free chill water that can be generated through the waste heat recovery. If 100% chilling is required, if customer want a steam and chill water, so in that scenario we can offer 450 to 500 kg of steam that can be generated through the waste heat recovery that we can install this boiler, and the chilling is around 80 to 90 TR chilling can be generated. So again what is the client demand or requirement in terms of utility that can be a bifurcate and we can offer. So 800 is a minimum size which we are offering to in the tri-generation segment.
Okay, thank you so much. We can now go on to the concluding remarks in the way forward. And I have with us Mr. Girja Shankar, who's working with ESL as head corporate driven programs. In ESL, he's worked as cluster head commissioned about 100 megawatt decentralized solar system and created institutional setup in Kerala for conversion of public vehicle to electric vehicles. Previously, he has worked as joint director in Bureau of Energy Efficiency under the National Mission on Enhanced Energy Efficiency and accomplished various projects. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sumedha. I think it is a privilege for me to provide the vote of thanks and the concluding remark. So it is a very interactive, I think, sessions we have, and the details on the three programs of the ESL, the SEC program, the generation, and the motor replacement program, it is discussed in the detailed out, and very good interactive. I think the questions we have received from the users and the participants. So I just want to highlight that initial remarks, the Ganayak sir has told that the integrated energy efficiency solution, which I think we are propagating under this corporate driven program, and this IES model, the integrated energy efficiency services, it is the bunch of the services we are offered to the different industrial and other clients. So under this, we are proposing the one, maybe the benchmarking and feasibility study for the requirement. So under that, we do the diagnostic study of that plant or the building or other the details of the organization. And based on that benchmarking and the feasibility study, we able to provide the different solutions. So it may be covering all these three programs, the National Motor Replacement Program, Super Efficient Air Conditioning Program, Tri-Generation. And not only these, we can also include the other technologies. As the Asana sir in the highlighted that ESL under the ZEP5 project implemented few other industrial energy efficiency projects like the compressor, jet drying machine, and the other technologies. So under ZEP5, we have so far there are approved more than 20 technologies which may be useful for the different type of the cluster and different type of application. Among out of these 20 technologies, I think more than 10 technology are the cross sector technologies. So I request the, all the participants, participant can participate in this IES model, and we are happy to provide all type of the solution covering from the diagnosis study to the concluding concluding in the implementation of the program. So ESL with the, this unique solution of the demand aggregation and the competitive bidding at a large scale, where the cost is reduced down and we are able to provide a very affordable and cost economical solution to the different type of the users. So I request them, if the participant wants to participate in this program, and if they need a more clarification, they can write to the respective program organization, or they can also reach out to me. And at the end, I want to send my sincere thanks to the IEC to collaborate with the ESL and just convene this a very interactive web meeting, where the most of the large number of participants have participated, and we are able to provide details of the different program, and the users and the participant can be benefited from them. So my sincere thanks to our executive director, Sri S.P. Ganayak sir, Mr. Sanjay Dubey, the Astana sir, I think is one of the I think technology solution, we are getting a n number of guidance from him. And thanks to the Jayesh, my colleague Jayesh, Anand Shukla, and Manoj, and Abhishek Dupar. Abhishek Dupar, the international cooperation is also one of the big partner. So at the concluding, I want that whosoever if want to participate in our program, so we are looking forward with them as a partnership, where we are able to bring the more investment and bring few value addition proposition, as the Ganayaks are told in the initial remarks. So they can be benefited from the demand aggregation, cost reduction, and other value added warranty related services. So with these remarks, Meta, I think you and your team have done a very wonderful work. So thanks to everyone. If I have missed out someone, so it is my just regret from my side, but it is very, very, I think, the good partnership with the IEC. We are able to convene this dialogue, and it may be able to convert some major impact in the whosoever participated here. They will be able to get some more benefit from this webinar. Thanks a lot. Thanks from my side.
Thank you so much, sir, for those words. And with this, we have come to the end of this webinar. The recording of the webinar will be shared with all the participants. We would like to thank you all for participating. If there are any further comments, questions, feedbacks, please feel free to contact us or any respective speakers, and we would be happy to get you in touch with ESL. Thank you and have a great day ahead.